Pastor Steve Herman. Welcome to Richwood United Methodist Church. It's the second Sunday in the season of Advent, and we're singing familiar Christmas carols. Sing along. Before the Lord in prayer together, let's lift our hearts together. Let us pray. Lord, we thank you for the gift of this Advent season. We thank you for a chance to prepare our hearts and minds for the coming of Christ and the celebration of the birth of Christ on Christmas. This is a different Advent, a different year for sure. And we pray for those who are isolated during this season of the year, those who can't be with their loved ones that they're usually with, that you will lift our spirits, fill us with the love and hope of the season, and the joy and peace of Christ, we pray. We pray for those who are grieving the loss of loved ones this year, and those who are still in an anxious position because of the pandemic, dealing with all the uncertainties of life, for teachers, parents, students, for people who have to work in essential businesses that are risky, for frontline healthcare workers. We pray for us all, Lord. See us through these very unusual days, the end of this 2020 and the beginning of this new Christian year. These blessings we ask in the name of Christ, who taught us to pray together with these words. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Good to have the band playing for the Lord and for us today.
I'm gonna make a wish this Christmas. Stop here for a moment, for the moment disappears. World's in a hurry this December, city streets and shopping malls. Wish we could slow down and remember the meaning of it all. Christmas. of your family, calling up an old lost friend. You can even find it in the eyes of a stranger when you reach out a helping hand.
Share a few announcements with you. Today is the last day for cookie sale orders. Like everything else, it's different because of the pandemic. We used to invite people into the fellowship hall for the cookie sale and the Christmas crafts, and we don't have the Christmas crafters here this year, and nobody's coming into the hall for cookies. It's all pre-boxed and curbside pickup. But today's the last day to order your homemade Christmas cookies. And then they'll be picked up next Saturday. Also, thanks for everybody who supported the grave blankets. Thanks for putting that together, Mildred. And I think there was a record number of those again, 130-some grave blankets made this year. Appreciate everybody who helped out with that. Also, you're big-hearted people. You have been very responsive to our mission projects lately. The blankets, the coats for the homeless in Camden, Kids Alley toys, all of those things, Peter's Pantry. You're just a kind-hearted people, so we thank you for all of your generosity in those areas. Also, as things are right now, we are still worshiping in person under the guidelines of separation and social distancing and masks. And therefore, we're planning on candlelight service. We're planning on three services that night. And you can check on our website for the details, richwoodchurch.org. And you'll see that what we're going to do is you can sign up online for the service of your choice, 4:30, 6 o'clock, or 7:30. And if you have any questions about all that, you can call the church. But look first online at richwoodchurch.org. Also, I want to thank those who have been so faithful with your tithes and offerings. Still mailing to the church at P.O. Box 7, Richwood, New Jersey, 08074. Or some are still using the link at our website that takes you to the conference. And you can put in our church number, and a lot are still giving them that way, using your credit cards. So what that has really done is just been beyond what I could imagine in enabling the church to, it looks like, finish out the year with our income and expenses balancing out, which is going to enable us to use our Christmas Eve offering for missions outside the church, which is what we like to do when we can each year. So again, God bless you and thank you. All right, we're going to listen to scripture this morning, and Liam's going to read for us.
Good morning. I'll be reading from 1 John chapter 4, verses 7 through 11, God's love and ours. Dear friends, let us love one another, for love comes from God. Everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. Whosoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. This is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. Dear friends, since God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. Have a great rest of your day.
I will remind you before we go to the Word this morning that this is the first Sunday of the month and we'll be serving communion. And anytime between now and then, if you want to pause your video and prepare for communion, just prepare yourself some bread or a wafer of any kind, or for your cup, water, wine, grape juice, whatever you have at home, and you can prepare to receive communion this morning. So during this Advent season, we're looking at songs of the season. Last week, we lit the first candle of Advent, a candle that represented hope, and we talked about songs of hope. And this week, we're lighting a candle that represents love. A common theme of Advent is the four candles of hope, love, joy, and peace. And we're going to talk about songs of love as well as scriptures of love. So let's pray. Lord, open our hearts and minds to all you would say to us this morning. We are thankful for this season, and we're thankful for an opportunity to focus on the love of God. Amen. So, two candles. One lit for hope last week and two this week, hope and love. And we're talking about songs of the season. So kind of bear with me here. Let's stretch our thinking a little bit. Love songs, songs about love. There's a lot of them, aren't there? I Googled some of those just to see how many. And some estimates are that there have been over 100 million love songs written. 100 million, that's a lot. Well, how would you even begin to determine what was the top one? What's the number one love song? There are a lot of different ways. One interesting thing was, though, the oldest love song, according to a lot of people, is actually found in the Bible. And do you know what that is? The Song of Solomon, right? And some say that's the oldest or first love song. Top love song of all time? Hard to say. They determine it different ways, some by surveys, some by play, some by actual sales. But it seems like many agree that the top love song of all time is I Will Always Love You, written by Dolly Parton, but sung by Whitney Houston. There are other opinions, though, and I also saw that some say the top love song of all time is I Can't Help Falling in Love with You by Elvis Presley. That's a favorite of mine. But we have to narrow our focus, right? We're talking about songs that are Christian in nature. So top Christian love songs, and according to a website, GoodTube, the top Christian love song is The Day Before You by Matthew West. Now, I know who Matthew West is, but I'm not familiar with that song, The Day Before You. Maybe you are. But if I was asked about the number one Christian love song from a Methodist hymnal point of view, I would say Love Divine, All Loves Excelling. That's the one that Charles Wesley wrote, and you're probably familiar with that. But on a broader scale, among a larger segment of Christianity than just the Methodists, how about Love Lifted Me? Do you know that song? Love Lifted Me, when nothing else could help, Love Lifted Me. That's a favorite as well. So let's narrow our focus even a little more. We're looking for love songs that are Christian in nature about Christmas time, right? And that's a little harder to find. Secular is kind of easy to find. You know what the number one secular Christmas love song is? You probably do. All I Want for Christmas Is You, Mariah Carey. Seems like folks either love that song or hate that song. But how about a Christian or sacred song about love and Christmas time? That's a little harder to find. Hard to really narrow that down. Some might say Silent Night because of the verse that says, love of God, God love, loves pure light. And also the nature of how we sing it when we do candle lighting, that very symbolic setting. Well, the problem is that there aren't that many sacred Christmas songs that really explicitly are about love. Implicitly, yeah, they're all about the love of God, but explicitly, not so much. Not like joy. Joy is one of the themes of Advent, and that's easy to find. Joy to the world, joy, joy, joy. Lots of songs about joy. Or peace, another one of the themes of Advent. That's easy to find too. Peace on earth is in dozens of Christmas songs, that phrase. But there is one Christmas song in our hymnal that does emphasize not only the theme of love, but uses the word love. And I don't know if you know it or not, but it's the song Love Came Down at Christmas Time. And let me share a little bit of the story of that hymn. Like many hymns, it was first written as a poem. It was written by Christina Rossetti, and she wrote several poems, sacred poems. She suffered from poor health, and her deep faith is thought to be a way that provided solace to her in writing poetry. Rosetta's best known for her hymns that are Christmas carols. She wrote In the Bleak Midwinter. You might have heard that. In 1872 she wrote it. And she wrote Love Came Down at Christmas on December 29, 1885. And Love Came Down at Christmas presents this wonderful image of incarnate love descending to earth, heralded by star and angel. Indeed, if one includes the word lovely, love is mentioned 12 times in the three short stanzas of the song. Now, interestingly enough, the poem is based on 1 John 4, 7 through 11. Does that sound familiar? That's what Liam read this morning. And that passage mentions love 11 times. So both passages are filled with the word and the theme of love. British hymnologist Richard Watson said the sublime simplicity of this hymn is the mark of a very great writer. And this poem is the perfect antidote for those who find themselves recovering from the stress of a Christmas season induced by materialism. Now, I might add to that, induced by the pandemic this year. It provides a moment to reflect on the gift of love incarnate, love divine. So, if you're not familiar with it, I want to share the words of that hymn with you this morning. We're not going to sing it because it's an unfamiliar tune to us, but it is a beautiful, beautiful poem. Love came down at Christmas, love all lovely, love divine. Love was born at Christmas, star and angels gave the sign. Worship we the Godhead, love incarnate, love divine. Worship we our Jesus, but wherewith for sacred sign? Love shall be our token. Love be yours and love be mine. Love to God and others. Love for plea and gift and sign. Isn't that a beautiful poem and, of course, a beautiful hymn? But now we've really narrowed our focus Let's widen our focus a little bit by looking at the scriptures. Love, of course, is a major theme in the Bible. The word love appears in our English Bible 300 to 500 times, depending on which translation you look at. In fact, some people have said the entire Bible is God's love letter to his dearest creation of all, human beings. The Apostle John writes more about love than anybody else. In fact, he becomes known as John the Beloved, right? And the word love appears 57 times in his gospel. That's more than all the other gospels combined. And in his book, the first epistle of John, which we read from this morning, 46 times in that short little book, he mentions love. So let me read again what Liam read earlier and listen to the theme love jump out at us in 1 John 4:7-11. Dear friends, let us love one another, for love comes from God. Everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might have life through him. This is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. Dear friends, since God loves us, we ought also to love one another. Now, you probably know this, but the Greeks had 6 or 7 words for love. They had 3 that were mainly used in the New Testament, and those 3 were philios, eros, and agape. Philios is the word for family love, for brotherly love. We have the city of Philadelphia, the city of brotherly love. It enabled the Greeks to be much more specific with the word love. You know, we say, well, we love our children, and we also say we love our old slippers, right? And the Greeks didn't do that. They were much more specific. Philios was the love that you had for family. Eros was romantic love, falling in love. I heard a good riddle sort of along those lines the other day. It said, what has 400 actors, 5 writers, and 1 plot? And the answer is a Hallmark movie, the Hallmark movies. And of course, they're romantic, right? That's eros, that's romantic love. Oh, and by the way, the follow-up on that is, how do you turn a Hallmark movie into a Hallmark Christmas movie? Well, the answer to that was just add Christmas lights. So, boy meets girl, boy falls in love with girl, boy and girl break up, boy and girl get back together in the end, romantic love, that's the word eros. Then, the one that is of interest to us today is agape. Agape is the Greek word for divine love, God's love for us. And it's the word that was used and translated love in our reading today in 1 John. It's also the word that Paul used in 1 Corinthians 13 when he said, love is patient, love is kind, love does not envy, love does not boast. It's not proud, does not dishonor others. It's not self-seeking, not easily angered, keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices in the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. Love never fails. So in the Greek, it was abiding these 3, faith, hope, and agape. And the greatest of those was agape, love. It's the word that John used for love in John 3:16, the most well-known verse of all. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him would not perish, but have life everlasting. Love was God's motivation behind giving his Son. Without love, there would be no Christmas, because Jesus would never have been born, and it's his birth we celebrate at Christmas. In my own life, I know I became a Christian not so much because of fear of God or fear of dying and going to hell someday. I became a Christian because I became aware of this overwhelming love of God for me. Love so strong, love so deep, love I could not resist. And Christmas is our annual chance to realize again how much God loves us. Think about the love of God as you light that second candle of Advent this week. Let us pray. Lord, as we celebrate this second week of Advent, as we light a second candle, as we lift up the theme of love, help us to have hearts that are open to your overwhelming, incredibly deep and strong love for each and every one of us, as seen in Jesus Christ, born in Bethlehem's manger. We pray. Amen. I want to welcome you to the Lord's table this Advent season. And if you haven't had opportunity yet to prepare the elements and you want to join in communion, just pause your video and then come back with your wafer or bread and your cup of water or wine or juice. Join me in the great thanksgiving. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ, whom you sent in the fullness of time to be a light to the nations. You scatter the proud in the imagination of their hearts, and have mercy on those who fear you from generation to generation. You put down the mighty from their thrones and exalt those of low degree. You fill the hungry with good things, and the rich you send empty away. Your own Son came among us as a servant to be Emmanuel, your presence with us. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, Jesus took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us, as we proclaim the mystery of faith together. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. So as you take your bread, remember that it's the love of God that has been poured out for us. It's the love of God that motivated Jesus to come to earth. It's the love of God that we celebrate on this second Sunday in the Advent season. Take the bread representing the body of Christ. Break, be grateful, and eat. Take your cup, perhaps water, wine, juice, whatever you have. It's symbolic of so much more. It's symbolic of the very blood of Christ, poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of our sins. Yes, God loves us so much, he made a way for our sins to be forgiven, so that we might have the gift of life eternal. Take, drink, in memory of Christ who died for you, and be grateful. When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we do experience again anew the presence of our Lord Jesus Christ and celebrate his coming long ago in the manger, but also look forward to his coming in final victory. Amen. Let's join in our closing hymn. us again. And the blessings of God the Father, Jesus Christ the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and fill you with his love this Advent season and always. Amen.